My dear respected elders, brothers and sisters, and the viewers of the Daily Reminder Network, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, wa usalli wa usallimu ala ashrafil anbiya'i wal mursaleen, nabiyyina wa habibina wa qurrati a'yunina Muhammad ibn Abdullah, alayhi wa ala alihi wa ashabihi afdalu salati wa atammu taslim, amma ba'd. Indeed, all praise is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector, and curer. We ask Allah the Almighty to shower His choicest of blessings and salutations upon our beloved Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions, and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. Insha'Allah ta'ala, for tonight's heart softener, we will be touching on firasa, otherwise translated as visual acumen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in the noble Quran,
inna fi dhalika la ayatin lil mutawassimin.
And indeed, inna fi dhalik, in that, la ayat are signs for the mutawassimin. Now, who are the mutawassimin? Scholars of tafasir, many of the scholars of tafasir have commented in regard to this. Imam Mujahid rahimahullah, he states that the mutawassimin are the people who have deep visual acuity or deep visual insight, perception. So, and other scholars rahimahumullah have also mentioned that it is also said for people who observe very carefully and who look at things with in close detail. So firasa is visual acumen, is deep insight, very deep perception. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, and the hadith is in Tirmidhi, along the lines of these words, beware of the firasa of a believer. Allahu Akbar. Beware of the firasa of a believer, because he looks with the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The firasa of a believer is that he looks at you perhaps with the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recited the ayah I recited a few moments ago. Inna fi dhalika la ayatin lil mutawassimin. Allahu Akbar. So what is firasa? What is firasa? In reality, firasa is a sharp thought. Is a sharp thought that enters an individual's heart and it dominates the opinion of the heart. Allahu Akbar. It is a sharp thought that enters an individual's heart and then dominates the opinion of that person's heart, just as how a lion dominates over its prey. Allahu Akbar. And we call prey in Arabic farisa. Farisa. And scholars also state this is how the term firasa came about. Where the lion dominates over its prey. Just like that, this is a sharp thought that enters an individual's heart and dominates the opinion of the heart. And also, firasa is very closely linked, is very closely connected to three organs of an individual. Primarily being the heart, and then an individual's eyes, and then an individual's ears. The person looks with his eyes and then the messages go to the heart and then the heart determines it. So firasa is closely connected to these three organs. And firasa, the levels of firasa are generally determined by a person's iman. The stronger his iman is, the stronger the levels of firasa will be. Allahu Akbar. Let me give you a few incidents from the lives of our Salafun as-Salih. Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu was once seated in a gathering, and a man enters the gathering. A man, whilst he was coming towards the gathering, a man who was looking at a woman with lustful gazes. He was lustfully gazing at a particular woman, and then he comes and enters the gathering of Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu. The minute Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu saw the man, he states, it seems as if someone who has the traces of zina on his eyes has entered our gathering. Allahu Akbar. The man was shocked. The man was surprised. He cries out, is there wahi coming down even after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To which Uthman radiallahu anhu states, no, it's not wahi, it's not divine revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but rather it is from firasa, it is from the light that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon the believers. Allahu Akbar. Likewise, from the Imams, you have many anecdotes. Allahu Akbar. Shaykhul Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah. You see, this concept of firasa is discussed in detail by Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah in his book Madarijus Salikin, in which he states that Shaykhul Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he used to have so much of firasa, so much of visual acumen, that at times he would feel like, you know, I can't move with people. He would say to some people, if you only knew what I can see in you, Allahu Akbar. To which they would say, why don't you tell us what you can see in us? To which he stated, if I do that, none of you all will be with me. Because if I start doing that, none of you all would be amongst me. And it is also reported from Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, that he is reported to have said that when a person used to make ablution, he could see the sins falling off that person's limbs. Allahu Akbar. This is all from the karamat, from the miracles bestowed upon the righteous slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are all things which have been bestowed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Knowledge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it is also in accordance with the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We're not coming to say that these individuals have knowledge of the unseen, or that these individuals have knowledge of the unseen world. Nay, rather, this is from firasa. This is from visual acumen. This is from the deep, strong, keen perception that they have. This is the deep insight that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed them with. Likewise, we too, if we work on our hearts, if we work on our iman, Allah the Almighty will bless us too with firasa, with the deep insight, where we will be able to see things a lot clearer. Let me share with you all an incident, a very amazing and interesting incident that took place in the lands of Arabia. And this took place, scholars mentioned, during the Ottoman Empire. There are a few versions to the incident. In other words, some people state that there were four sons involved in this incident, and some state that there were only three. We will stick to the narration where it states that there were three sons. There was a man who had three sons, and he named all three sons Abdullah. Abdullah. He named all three sons as Abdullah. You could say Abdullah Senior, Abdullah Junior, maybe however you want to call it. He named all three sons Abdullah. And on his deathbed, he called his three sons and he said, Abdullah, number one, you will inherit from me. Abdullah, number two, you will inherit from me. Abdullah, number three, you will not inherit from me. And then he passes away. Now the three sons were in confusion. Now what is this? We are all three sons, but then our father has stated it that, you know, number one will inherit, number two will inherit, but number three will not inherit. So they were in confusion. So they thought of taking this issue, and anyway, all of the paperwork and stuff like that had to be done. Let's take it up in the courts. Let's put this forward. Let's put the case in front of the judge, the Qadi, and let's hear what he has to say. We'll tell him the whole story. So now they had to travel from where they used to live to the land where the Qadi used to live. So they started their journey. On the way, these three, now you see, the three boys had been blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because they were very righteous. They were very righteous youngsters who used to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now they were traveling and suddenly they notice something. They notice something funny in the sense, on the way, in their journey, they noticed some footprints of an animal, and they noticed all these things. And as they were going, suddenly another man comes from behind and he is upset. He is looking for something, he's searching, and then the minute he sees these three young boys, he says, I have lost my camel. I have lost my camel. By any chance, have you spotted the camel anywhere? Perhaps whilst you were coming through your on your path, perhaps did you ever come across my camel? Then the three boys, the first boy said, is your camel awar? Is your camel awar? Is your camel one-eyed? In other words, blind in one eye. To which he says, yes, yes. Then the second boy said, is your camel abitar? Is your camel, in the sense, your camel's tail has been cut off? To which he said, yes, that's my camel, that's my camel. The third boy asked, your camel, does it have a bit of a limp? It limps, right? One leg is a bit faulty. It limps on one leg. To which the man said, exactly, that is my camel. My camel is one-eyed, my camel's tail has been cut off, and my camel limps. Did you see, where is my camel? And then the young boy said, no, we haven't seen your camel. Then they asked him, how do you know of my camel? In other words, you're describing my camel perfectly. How do you know of it? I think I have to take you to the Qadi too. They were like, okay, we haven't seen your camel, but if you want to take the case up with the judge, let's do so. Now they all travel and they reach the judge's house and they go up to the judge. And before the youngsters put their case forward, this man shouts out, oh Qadi, I have a case to put forward. The Qadi says, what is wrong with you, Ya Rajul? What's the problem? What do you have? What's your problem? To which he narrates the story that, you know, the three boys, they were traveling and they described my camel perfectly. They have seen my camel and they've hidden my camel somewhere. Then the Qadi says, youngsters, how do you know of this man's camel? In other words, how are you so accurately describing this man's camel? The first boy says, well, I said the camel must have been one-eyed because I noticed that on the way, you know, wherever there were tiny plants that were growing, only one side of the plant was eaten and the other side wasn't eaten. So from that, I determined that the camel has to be one-eyed, and that's why I asked him, and it was right. Okay, you're excused. How do you know that the camel is, his tail has been cut off? Then that boy explains, wherever I saw that the camel has taken rest, I noticed that they were very observant. Normally we would see the shape of a tail, but in regard to this camel, that shape wasn't there. So I came to a conclusion that the tail must have been cut. Okay, you're also excused. How do you know, oh third boy, that the camel was limping? Then he stated, well, there were only three footprints on the ground. The fourth footprint wasn't there. A camel has four legs, so there is no three-legged camel. So from that I came to a conclusion that the camel has a limp. The Qadi addressed the man saying, you have no business over here. These youngsters don't have your camel. You may go. You may go. And then now he asks him, oh youngsters, what brings you all here? Now they relate unto him their story of what their father said. And they said, no, we have all of this wealth. We're wondering how to divide the inheritance, because our father has instructed that the number one should inherit, number two should inherit, number three should not inherit. The Qadi was a bit perplexed, and then he said, you know what, you've traveled so far, why don't you stay the night over at my place, enjoy, I'll be a good host, and next day morning let's talk about this case. So that night they were guests in the Qadi's house. Now, as they were in the room, in the guest room perhaps, all three of them sensed that there was something fishy, and they came to a conclusion, the Qadi has put someone to spy on us. And then they determined that because they saw someone by the window closely observing them. So this was observation number one. And then food comes now, a servant brings food for them, and there was meat, there was bread. So they started eating the meat. The minute they started eating the meat, and halfway through one boy says, you know what, there's something fishy here. This is not the meat of a cow or sheep. Rather, this is the meat of a dog. Now, the servant who brought the food was a bit upset. How did this person come to this conclusion? Then the other boy who was eating the bread, he said, you know what, this bread has been kneaded by a woman who is pregnant 9 months. Now, this was even more astounding. How does he know that the woman who, you know, pressed the dough perhaps is 9 months pregnant? And then the third boy says, you know what, I have a funny feeling about this Qadi. I have a feeling that he is an illegitimate child. He is an illegitimate child. He is not a child born out of a pure wedlock. Allahu Akbar. Now this is even amazing. The next day morning, the servant goes to the Qadi and informs him of everything. The Qadi is a bit upset. He calls for the three boys, and then he asks the first boy, what made you say that I served you dog meat? Then the boy said, oh respected Qadi, in general when we used to eat meat, we first encounter the bone, and then it is flesh, and then it is fat. But in the meat that you served us, we came across bone, and then fat, and then flesh. And we know, because we have hunting dogs, we know that this is closely related to dog meat, and that is why I came upon that conclusion. He calls the chef, come over, and then he asks him, what was the meat you cooked yesterday? Tell me the truth or I'll have you beheaded. The chef, he says, I'm sorry Qadi, but you gave me very short notice that guests have come, and I was waiting for the butcher to bring meat, but he didn't bring meat, and there was no meat at home. There was this dog by the side of the kitchen. I slaughtered the dog and I cooked the dog. Allahu Akbar. So observation number one is correct. Number two, he asked him, He asked the second boy, how do you know that this bread was needed by a woman who is 9 months pregnant? He stated, it's very simple, because a 9 months pregnant woman has a big tummy. Yeah. So, you know, the bread was kneaded in such a way that one side of it was soft and the other side of it was hard. So from that, I understood that she was finding it very difficult to properly knead the bread. So then the qadi calls out, who was the lady who kneaded the bread? Ya Umm Fulan, come here. And then the lady comes. When she comes, they see that she is pregnant. She is 9 months pregnant. So that is also confirmed. Now the third thing, he asks him, youngster, how do you know that I am an illegitimate child of my parents? That boy says, you see, amongst the Arabs, we never put spies to spy on our guests. The minute you put a spy to spy on us, I came to a conclusion that you are not from a noble family, you are an illegitimate child. The king, the qadi was upset. He got up and he went right to his mother and he asked his mother, oh my mother, fear Allah and tell me, am I the child of my mother and my father? Tell me the truth. The mother says, I'm sorry my son, this is a secret that we kept hidden, but we did not want this rulership to go somewhere else because we didn't have children. So what I did was I had an illegal relationship with one of my cousins because your father was seriously ill and you were born through that relationship. The qadi was upset. He comes back and now he is going to decree in regard to their inheritance. So he tells the first boy, Abdullah, number one, you will inherit from your father's wealth. You will inherit from your father's wealth. And then he says, Abdullah, number two, you will also inherit from your father's wealth. And then he says, Abdullah, number three, you will not inherit from your father's wealth. Abdullah, number three, very perplexed, he asked him, oh Qadi, what makes you say so? What makes you say that I will not inherit from my father's wealth? The Qadi says, it's very simple. I was just analyzing the statements of your father and I have come to a conclusion that even though you identified me as being a bastard, you did not identify that you are also an illegitimate child of your father. Allahu Akbar. The boy goes back, they go back, all of them go back and they ask their parents and then it is true. The mother says, long time back, your father went by the masjid and there was this lady, young lady with you, she had given birth to you, the third boy, and there was no father to look after. Your father adopted you. Allahu Akbar. So we know that the adopted child cannot inherit. This is from firasa and this is from deep inside. This has to do with an intelligence of an individual and also in regard to the iman of an individual. The stronger the levels of iman be in an individual's heart, the stronger the levels of firasa will be. So may Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all with firasa, with deep visual acumen, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive our sins. May He the Almighty accept our good deeds and may He unite us in the gardens of Jannah with our beloved Master Muhammad sallallahu عليه وسلم وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين جزاكم الله خير.